Gardens. We go talk about some stuff. Hi. It's been a long time. There's a really romantic scene here. You got the waves coming in. Got the golden sun in the sky. Got the mountains in the distance. Seattle's absolutely spectacular. I love it here. I wanted to... Now, I want to talk about what has happened since my last episode in September, and just give like a perspective of the past. And my perspective today and my perspective for the future, and touch on a little bit about why I have this channel, why I started it in the first place. I made this YouTube channel, one, to document this adventure that I feel like I'm on. It is incredible when I think about it. I remember sitting at my desk in the Air Force, and this top secret facility, no windows, poor lighting, and you know, I felt like I was in the wrong place. I felt like that's where I needed to be at that time, but that there was something else for me, and that I would have to go after it. You know, I would have to have the courage. And, you know, Major League Rugby presented that opportunity. I got a contract from the Seattle Seawolves, and that's all I really needed. It's like, this is what God wants me to do. So I packed my bags and I left. And at that time, I had a lot of self-doubt. You know, I hadn't played rugby in 2 years. And but I went for it. You know, I wanted to discover who I am. Like, what am I made out of? To leave this Air Force, you know, kind of like a socialist society, because medical's free, you know, you can get paid for the rest of your life doing that if you want, and it's a really comfortable life. I certainly admire the honor that there is in fighting for your country. But I felt like there was another calling for me. So I packed my bags, I left for Seattle, and we got it done. We won a championship, and that was just really, really incredible. I couldn't imagine all the emotions that I would feel. I know I love rugby, just playing and being out there, but to have sold out stadium, and to have the fans that we did, and to do it without a coach, it was just the testament to the men and the team. And that was kind of boom, that was our foundation, season one. Then we went into season two. They doubled the amount of regular season games. There was a lot more hype, there was a lot more pressure, and with pressure comes stress. But you know, we got it done. And I learned a lot about myself. I was humbled a lot. And season two. And, you know, I, that summer of 2019, lived life. Then my last episode that I shot was in September, and about 2 weeks later I cut my hair. I just had this Britney Spears moment where I was disappointed, I was frustrated with who I was becoming. And I was proud that we had won 2 championships, but I wasn't really proud of how I was showing up. You know, whether it was training, celebrating, just my lifestyle. It didn't feel aligned with who I truly wanted to be, which is the best rugby player that I can be. And I'm gonna talk a little bit about that. But I cut my hair and I told myself that season 3, I got something to prove to myself. I want to do this season. I want to honor the person that I want to be. Season 3 was going to be different. And it was a rough start. It was the roughest start we had in our franchise history. So maybe it was a blessing from God that the coronavirus happened. And man, talk about something that I could not have expected. I don't think any of us expected that. It's a once in a century kind of pandemic. A once in a century act of God. And it's still going on from March. It's the longest thing that's ever impacted my life. And it's like the whole world got sick. Just a weird time, a weird time. But it's given me a lot of time to reflect on who I want to be. And that kind of happened during the George Floyd Black Lives Matter movement. As a black person in a city with 4% black people, you realize how different you are. I really felt like black. when the riots started, you know, everyone just had like a lot of questions. I was just put into a different kind of spotlight, and there were different kind of expectations. People wanted to know what I thought. People wanted to, I don't know, they may have thought I was angry at them. Whatever the case may be, there was a lot of emotion from both sides all around. And there was kind of a, you know, where do we go from here? And that kind of brings me to another point. Black Lives Matter, saying that. It was really powerful for me to say that my life mattered, to say that dark-skinned people's lives mattered, because it doesn't feel like that. Sometimes it can feel like we're at the bottom, and there's kind of like a historical precedence to that, right? That's the way people used to think. And so I think this movement is truly bringing that kind of stuff to light, that maybe we need to re-examine our biases. But I do want to say that Black Lives Matter, Brown Lives Matter, Red Lives Matter, Yellow Lives Matter, and White Lives Matter. I love everyone. Every single person's life matters. And one thing I've learned from this movement is that it's important to say how much you value someone, how much you love them. And I wish that everyone could have a march on their behalf. But I support the Black Lives Matter movement, and I really appreciate the people that are stepping up. I don't believe in the politics that it's turned into, the agenda, you know, Marxism, socialism, defund the police, okay, I get that, but really we're talking about the content of someone's heart. Like the police, we can change that, fine. We certainly do need more mental health professionals, because that's kind of like the bulk of what they're dealing with. But you know, it's deeper than just the police. That's kind of like a symptom. You know, like, really examine what's going on in your heart, and find a way to love. So I'm gonna try and do my part, and I want you to know that I love you. If you're watching this, I love you, no matter your skin color. So that brings me to today. Life is more precious now. You know, when you see that there's like 1,000 people dying a day from this invisible disease, it's scary. And I remember at the beginning of the coronavirus, I was pretty down. I was checking the news like every morning, and that was not good. Not good. But you know, I grew up a lot from it, and what doesn't kill you makes you stronger, potentially. And I, you know, it made me think about my values, like, who do I want to be and what am I about? If you know me, like, I'm all about self-actualization and optimal experience, peak human experiences, humor. I realized that, you know, life doesn't have to be so serious. Sometimes I've been really serious, you know, and it's usually because you're stressed. But find humor. Haha. Tell a joke. You know. Why can't the teddy bear eat dessert? Because he's stuffed. I love that joke. Mental toughness. That is something that I feel is really important to talk about. If you are going to self-actualize, in order to do that, you have to overcome challenges. You have to be committed to your goal, and then be willing to take on whatever comes. And you know, you can get knocked down, but you gotta get back up. That's what mental toughness is. And the faster you get up is the tougher that you are. You know, it's that simple. So if you get knocked down for a long time, whether it's depression, whether it's you're hungover, I'm gonna say it's because you're a little mentally weak. I don't mean that to offend you, but I want you to recognize that we need to focus on what we can control. Part of that is feeling comfortable in your own skin, being authentic. Part of that is committing to your goals, making it specific, measurable, attainable, relevant, and time-bound. They call that SMART goals. That helps you commit to it, because now you can visualize what you're supposed to do. When you set those goals, you gotta realize that there will be challenges along the way. And whatever those challenges are that the world throws to you, know that God doesn't give you more than you can handle, and that you need to go through that in order to achieve the reward that you're seeking. And then you have to have confidence. And confidence, you know, you can fake it till you make it. That's a strategy. But it's also built by having definable goals, by seeing yourself defeat challenges, and focusing on what you can control. And then it also helps to have some faith. During this time, I've kind of refound Christ and found this path of wholeness and this path of perfection which he taught, that we're supposed to seek. And it's a common theme in all religions. I don't think that Christianity is the best one. It's the one that works for me. So find, you know, whatever your God is, have faith in what he's trying to tell you. Have faith that you were brought here for a reason. You know, believe that. Remind yourself that. Because it's a foundation of rock that you can stand upon. If you don't know why you're here, if you're always doubting yourself, it's hard to move fast. And we are all at different levels in life. We're all like moving towards perfection ideally. And so be patient with your journey as well. So that's kind of where I'm at right now. Before I talk about the future, I'm gonna go down into that water. So let's go check it out. A year ago, I went on a road trip to LA. Can't believe it's been that long. What's going on, beautiful people? I'm in Hollywood. About to go on a 19-hour drive back to Seattle. I literally saw someone doing crack, smoking crack on my drive here to Starbucks. This place is wild. But looking forward to the journey. It's gonna take me about 2 or 3 days. It's in about 99 degrees right now. Let's do this. It's gorgeous. It's also a little cold. One year from now, I want to be the 2021 Major League Rugby champion. You know, when I talk about focusing on what you control, and I can't control whether we win, but what I can control is how hard I work from now until then. How much effort I put in, how much I support my teammates, showing up with virtue, being punctual. There's a lot that you can control to affect that result. And it doesn't really matter if I win or lose. I mean, that's what I want to do. I want to win. But I want to focus on what it is that I can control. It gives me a lot, like a sense of peace doing that. So in 1 year, I want to tell you that we are the MLR champions, that I did it with virtue, and that I made myself proud. That's a future worth living for. So, moving forward, and I want to take you on that adventure. Come on, let's go. I don't know if I can shoot an episode every week, but I want to shoot one once a month until next July. And I'm gonna commit to that. So, whether the season gets hard, it gets tough, challenges pop up, just do it. And to end this, I just want to say how sincerely I appreciate the people that have supported me through this journey, the people that believed in me. It means a lot. It took a lot to get to this point, and I could not have done it alone. You know, my family, my friends, my fans, I really appreciate you, and I love you guys. And I want to see you thrive and succeed. I hope to be an example for you. To take risks, to go after your dream. To seek peak human experiences. To seek God. To be humble, be willing to learn, and to tell a joke every once in a while. Practice a little humor, a little lightness. So I think I accomplished what I set out to do with this video. I am committing to you, and I'm committing to myself, focusing on what I can control, and just let's try to live a beautiful life. We can get through this. There's a lot on our plate right now. You know, you hear some people say it's the end of the world. Change can feel like that, right? But I believe in you. Keep going. Set goals, commit to them, get to know who you are. Practice authenticity, feel comfortable in your own skin, and your confidence will grow. It just does naturally. So, you know, have a lovely day. Cheers. Thank you.